Now, as we reported, Philippine inflation was steady at 3% in February. Joining us now for a quick inflation analysis and his take on the markets, Alvin Arogo of PNB. Hi, Alvin. Good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning, and thank you for having me.
All right. So clearly, the Ukraine crisis has not been factored into the February inflation print. At this point, what is your outlook for inflation in the medium term?
Yeah, before the Ukraine crisis, our forecast for the whole year is an average of 3.4%. As you mentioned, the data came out this morning. It is pretty in line with what we were expecting for Feb. So our forecast for Feb is 3.1%. The actual number is 3%. But this week, we actually sent a note to our clients saying that there are two commodities that will be hit by the Russia-Ukraine crisis, namely crude oil, so Dubai crude for the Philippines, as well as wheat. And so we're still reviewing our numbers, but most likely we will revise it closer to 4%.
Mm-hmm. Closer to 4%, but still within government's target range of 2 to 4%.
Still within, but a lot of that assumption is that the average for crude oil this year should not go above $110 per barrel. So I'm not saying that it shouldn't touch over $110 per barrel, but as long as the average for the entire year is about $110 per barrel, then close to 4% inflation is still achievable. But since we are in a unprecedented geopolitical event at this point, the risk is still tilted towards the upside. So if the ongoing crisis continues, if the sanction becomes heavier than what we see right now, then an average crude oil above $110 per barrel is not impossible to happen. And so our stance is, yes, our forecast as a baseline will be revised close to 4%, but it doesn't completely rule out the possibility of an inflation above 4%.
Okay. And with that expectation, is the market under or overestimating price pressures at this point?
At this point, I think the market is still cautiously optimistic about the price pressure. If you look at the 10-year BVAL, it closed yesterday at 5.3%. It is up 53 basis points so far this year. But note that during 2018, we saw the 10-year BVAL rising above 7%. And our forecast for the year is 6%. So clearly, it has priced in some of the inflation pressure, but it is still cautiously optimistic, balancing the encouraging print, which is 3% so far this year, with the possibility that it will be closer to 4% for the entire year of 2022.
With expectations or risk tilted to the upside for inflation, how should we now adjust portfolios? I mean, which companies should we be hedging with? You did say two commodities are going to take a hit from this Russia-Ukraine crisis. It's going to be crude and wheat. I can think of several companies, listed companies, who are heavily dependent on these two.
Yes. Well, on fundamentals alone, the companies that are able to pass on the higher cost to consumers would be ideal. However, as we can see, since most investors are thinking the same, overvaluation tends to occur. So for example, in the consumer space, we know that Universal Robina is dependent on wheat, but at the same time, we know that their valuation as well is already pricing in a lot of that risk. On the other hand, we do like Jollibee's ability to pass on higher costs due to their strong brand equity and diversify the portfolio of quick service restaurants. However, with a PE of over 60 times, I don't think it's a stock that investors should be heavily exposed in right now. So our advice to investors is still look for relatively cheap stocks with strong catalyst. And while it is important to look at the fundamentals in terms of their ability to pass on prices, never forget to look what the PE is saying about what investors are already saying about these stocks.
Okay, Alvin, we have this just in. The PSE index has opened trade during the first minute since the opening bell, the last trading day for this week, and it's actually opening lower by a quarter of 1%, 73.69. Really, no surprise, we're joining the rest of Asia trade lower this morning. You know, when you look at inflation that could squeeze margins, you look at the earnings outlook, and you talked about this, the current valuations of companies. What now is your medium and your long-term view on the PSE index for those who want to buy the 30, the basket of 30 stocks, the index? Yeah.
So at the start of the year, we told our investors that I expect the PSE index to continue to trade at a wide range. So our baseline forecast is 7.5. We have a bear case of 6.8. And we have a bull case of 8 to 40. In other words, once it gets closer to 6.8, that is when you have to aggressively invest in the market. At 7.5, it's still good to invest, but you have to worry about the downside risk. So for us, the best strategy is still to look to capitalize on that wide trading range and buy aggressively closer to 6.8, maybe take some profits at 7.5. But if you're really optimistic, hold on to it and wait until the 8,000 level.
All right. So I just wanted to bring this in. We have this from the governor, the BSP governor, still on inflation. We just wanted to share with the audience a statement from BSP Governor Ben Jokno saying the recent increases in global crude oil prices due to the Russia-Ukraine conflict have raised global and domestic macroeconomic uncertainty over the near term. Under these circumstances, the BSP will monitor closely emerging risks to the outlook for inflation and remain vigilant against possible second round effects from supply side pressures or any shifts in inflationary expectations. The BSP supports the implementation of non-monetary measures by the national government to help mitigate the impact of higher oil prices and avoid the broadening of price pressures. Of course, he's probably referring to the fuel subsidy, the 2.5 billion peso fuel subsidy being prepared by government. Very quickly, do you think that this inflation, the change in inflation trajectory could force the hand of the Philippine Central Bank to move sooner and sharper with all the hikes expected?
Well, it certainly makes their job more difficult, unfortunately. But we have to understand as well that there is an upcoming election. And as of December last year, the Philippine economy is still about 3.5% below its pre-pandemic level. So this inflation pressure would certainly support our call that the BSP would raise the policy rate this year by a total of 50 basis points. However, I do not think that they will move before election and shortly after election. That's why our forecast is that the first move of the BSP will happen sometime in June, and then that's 25 basis points and another 25 basis points in September.
All right, so that's what the market seems to be pricing in. Alvin, let's go over some interesting corporate stories for today. ICTSI, this was actually from yesterday, but I wanted to get your take. ICTSI, the port operator of Magnet Enrique Azuan, is doubling their capital expenditures this year to $330 million. They're saying, while the worst may be over for COVID-19, the Russia and Ukraine crisis needs to be monitored. Are you liking the ports business for Enrique Azuan? When you look at the other businesses he's into utilities, he's into the casino with Bloomberry, and then the ports. Are you liking the ports?
The business itself, we like it. However, in terms of the rating, we're actually neutral on ICTSI. I think the stock price is already way ahead of its historical high. And of course, while the worst is over, well, it seems like the worst is over for COVID, I don't think we can underestimate the contagion of this geopolitical risk between Russia and Ukraine and how it can spread for the entire Europe. So at the price level where ICTSI is right now, I think it fairly, if not fully, reflects all the strong performance it had in 2021 and going into 2022.
All right. And this one, Jollibee, you mentioned this earlier, how it's still expensive, but Jollibee has opened a new store in Vancouver. This is, they opened to really long lines of eager foodies who wanted that chicken joy. This is their 23rd store in Canada. We did get a lot of positive news in the earnings front for Jollibee, but you did say it's still pretty expensive, right?
Yes, I mean, it's amazing as a Filipino to see how other countries are patronizing Jollibee. Mm. But at 68 times PE, it's just for me a hard stock to recommend on an aggressive basis. I'm not saying that the stock price will go down aggressively, but if you invest right now, you have to believe that the PE will go over 68, which is way above what the market is currently trading right now.
All right. From Jollibee, let's go to Meralco. Meralco is expecting power sales to go up 6% or even more this year as restrictions ease to alert level one. Quick comment on that?
Yeah, well, the numbers make sense because power demand is closely linked to GDP growth. Our GDP growth
and
the reopening, exactly. And our GDP growth forecast this year is 6.6%. So their view of going up by at least 6% or even more makes sense.
All right. And this one, this is actually not a listed company, but it's pretty interesting because it's has something to do with fundraising. The former Grab Philippine head, this is Brian Koo. He has a startup. It's Savvy Suki. It's a grocery, community grocery style business model. They just raised $10.7 million. There seems to be a lot of fundraising happening here. Despite being in a crisis, there's a lot of money really looking for places to park.
Yeah, exactly. And deliveries have been proven to be a very robust business, and it has accelerated way more than I think what most investors were expecting during the pandemic. And heading into the new normal, we have to remember that the Philippines has a telecommuting law, which allows us, even before the pandemic, to work from home where it makes sense. So for me, businesses like this make sense, and that's why they're getting a lot of support from investors.
We also have this PLDT. Fetches bids north of $50 billion for its towers, selling half of its 12,000 towers to two entities. And Robinson's Land is unveiling the expansion of Robinson's Place Antipolo this May. Total gross floor area is up by 40%. And we have this just in from D&L. Commercial operations of D&L's Natura Aeropack plant moved to January 2023. One foreign story I wanted to get your take on, Alvin, is Apple. Apple is gearing up for its first big product event of the year. They're calling it peak performance, and that's going to happen this coming March 8th. Now, Apple is rumored to be unveiling a series of new MacBooks and iMacs featuring the second iteration of its powerful in-house processor, as well as a 5G version of its more affordable iPhone SE smartphone and an updated iPad Air. This clearly straddles the consumption story and the tech story. Are you a big believer of the consumer story here in the Philippines? What sort of growth are you looking at?
Yeah, well, there is revenge spending in the Philippines. I think that much is very clear. I was out over the weekend, and for the people I've spoken with on the ground, they're saying that at least during Saturdays and Sundays, foot traffic and demand is very close to the pre-pandemic level. I think the problem is supply, right? So for any tech-related consumer electronics product, the demand is clearly there, especially with the with the reopening of the economy. The question is, can they supply enough to meet the demand of consumers?
All right. Alvin, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us, just describe it. We're going to leave it to our viewers to guess what this is if they want to take advantage of the upside. What do you have for us today?
Okay, hopefully I will not give a lot of clues that will reveal it. But okay, number one, the demand for its service is inelastic, meaning a price increase will not drastically impact demand because the service that they provide is something that we cannot live without.
Okay.
Second is, this company has a dominant presence in Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Third clue is that it is an exception to a generally frowned upon market structure. So it operates as an exception in a generally frowned upon market structure. Final clue, this stock can be considered as a fixed income substitute. It provides a consistent, tangible cash return to investors at a relatively high return, but as you can see from the chart, it is currently underappreciated by the market.
Okay, and what sort of upside are you seeing for this stock?
Hold on, just give me a second. The capital upside is around 31%. If we include the yield, the total return is 38%.
38%, that sounds pretty attractive. We're just gonna have to guess which stock this is if our viewers wanna take advantage of that upside, including yields and capital appreciation. Thank you so much, Alvin, for joining us. Have a great weekend.
Thank you for having me.